Happy Wednesday, happy sunshine on Washington Webinar Wednesdays. Welcome to webinar number 3 of our series, DC History. Today we're going to be all about First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy and her efforts to help preserve Lafayette Park, a chapter in her life and a chapter in DC history that is little known. I'm really happy today to be joined by two colleagues, two great women. When you are talking about someone as sort of foundational as Jacqueline Kennedy, you almost need three women on the screen with her to balance things out. I'm the official presenter, but I'm really glad to have my Washington Walks colleague, Victoria Reinsel here, who is a tour guide extraordinaire. But what a lot of you won't know is that she is the admin person for Washington Walks. And in short, there is no Washington Walks without Victoria. Today, she is going to handle the Q&A, but Victoria, also make an announcement that I think many people will be glad to hear about. Let's say they want to go back and listen to or look at a webinar that we've done in the past, and they may have been wondering, Washington Walks, where are they?
Well, good news on that front. The webinars are on our website now. There is actually, if you go up to the very top of our website, page, there's a webinars thing you can click on in the navigation bar that'll take you to a page that has all of the webinars that we have done, with the exception of the one on the cherry blossoms. Unfortunately, had a little technical glitch recording that. If you click on any one of those, you'll see that it takes you to an individual page with information about the webinar and also a video. That video connects to our brand new YouTube channel, which you can also go to directly. So you can watch the videos either on our website or on our brand new Washington Walks YouTube channel, which we highly recommend that you subscribe to.
Thank you. I know.
You're welcome.
Believe y'all, we have a YouTube channel. Also today, I am really pleased to have Laura Rocklyn, who is not a tour guide, but she is a colleague, certainly a lover of DC history. And interestingly, before COVID, she was in Boston in grad school. It's kind of the place we think about the Kennedys, but is back now in Alexandria. She is an actor, she's a writer, and the reason I wanted her to be here today is because she also works as, is this the right term, Laura? Living history person. Tell a little bit about your experience with that.
Absolutely. I mean, living history is a good word. We also, when we sound very technical, say first person historical interpretation. Sort of the idea is that we are trying to interpret history from the point of view of the people as they were living it, which is a wonderful way to use an acting background and a love of history and a love of writing. I started out with a college internship at Colonial Williamsburg. And since I've worked to places like Mount Vernon and the Smithsonian, and now with a wonderful group in Boston called History at Play, that this year has been focusing on the women of the suffrage movement, which has been very exciting.
I also know from your Instagram that I think you're pretty fond of Regency era.
I am. I must say, I portray all of these amazing American women, and yet the woman I'm asked to portray the most often is Jane Austen. Mm-hmm. I have a one-woman Jane Austen performance called Who Dares to Be an Authoress, and that's the one that I think is performed by far the most often.
Well, folks here will be glad to know, who are listening today, that on June 3, Laura's going to be back, along with a former Washington Walks guide, an actor and director and producer, Ty Hallmark, and we hope author Natalie Dykstra, to talk about a personal, real historic person who Laura has portrayed and has written about, and Ty and Natalie have written about, and that is Marion Hooper Adams, otherwise known as Clover Adams. So look for info about that coming up on our website and through email. Well, let's get started. I'm gonna stop this share on my screen And I'm going to share something else here. There we go. There she is. And I wanted to get an image of her later in her life, because what we're going to talk about today really does concern later in her life and after her death in 1994. Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis is a first lady whose legacy has endured, who people continue to be fascinated by, to admire, to mourn the loss, but she died only in her mid-60s. Victoria and Laura, what do you remember about when you sort of discovered or learned who Jacqueline Kennedy was?
For me, it was the fashion. She was so glamorous. And I was really drawn to her sort of chic, minimalistic, always dressing for the occasion. Like, there was just no question that she would be the best dressed woman in the room. I just loved her because of that. And it wasn't until years later, I think, that I learned about her work in historic preservation and her support for the arts and all of that. So, yeah.
And I think, how about you, Laura?
Well, as a little girl, I remember being very inspired by the idea that, you know, she and Mr. Kennedy talked about the idea of creating an American Camelot. And supporting the arts and bringing up this love of history. And I loved that ideal.
Well, in Washington, D.C., I think most people would think about, if they wanted to have a point of connection with Mrs. Kennedy, a direct one, they could probably go to the National Museum of American History, to the First Lady's gown collection, and see one of her gowns there. They also could visit her graveside in Arlington Cemetery. She's buried there with her husband, President Kennedy, with one of their children, Patrick, who passed away. And you can kind of go there and pay tribute. And you see from her dates, I mean, she's only 64 years old when she died. It's 1929 when she's born. And that's a date I want you to keep in mind when we're going to start our talk about Lafayette Park. A lesser known place, though, you could go to honor Mrs. Kennedy is right here. And this is the northwest corner of Lafayette Park, right in front of the Decatur House, where there's a simple, classically inspired pedestal with a plaque on top of it. And it would be really easy in a city that has many plaques and many pedestals to walk by this and really pay it no heed. And I dare say that happens all the time. But for those who do stop to look at it, this is what it says. When the historic character of Lafayette Square was severely threatened during her husband's administration, it was preserved with the vision and dedicated efforts of Jacqueline Bouvier Kennedy. This view from Decatur House is dedicated to her memory. And this was placed there by the National Trust for Historic Preservation not that long after her death. And again, this is in front of the Decatur House. That is a National Trust property.
Carolyn, if I might interrupt you for a moment, we are getting some feedback from our participants that they're not seeing the presentation. We're seeing right now kind of a bunch of files.
Okay. So what they're seeing instead is just the thumbnails.
Yes.
Oh, doggone it. I'm so sorry, folks. I am not sure. No, that's not going to help. Oh, shoot.
If you're wanting to show individual photos, if you just double click on them, they should get bigger, I would assume.
Yeah.
I don't know if you have like a...
No, Oh, people participating. I'm so sorry. I was for sure thinking this was going to work. Does that help? Anyone out there watching?
Not yet.
But Victoria and Laura can see this.
No. We're still seeing the files too.
Oh, darn it. Okay.
So it looks like you might have a different screen that you intended to make pop. I don't know if there are options.
Well, okay, let me try again. Thanks for your patience, everyone. Good grief. Okay.
There we go.
All right, people out there watching, does that help?
Yes. Okay, thank you, Carolyn.
Are you seeing this pedestal in Lafayette Park?
We sure are.
I'm so glad. Thanks for patience, everyone.
Say okay. This is brand new technology to a lot of us. It's
all good. I'm going to make this bigger. Okay. Well, here we go. We're still seeing it?
Yes.
Okay. Well, anyway, this pedestal and this plaque appeared soon after Mrs. Kennedy died, and it's telling us that the square is severely threatened during her husband's administration, and then there's this view that is dedicated to her honor. What is this all about, and what view are they talking about? I think the view they intend for the person standing by this pedestal to behold is the one of Jackson Place, the row of 19th century houses that's just south of the Decatur House. And here it is. This is what you would see today down Jackson Place. And then across from that, directly across on the east side of Lafayette Park, here is a former Benjamin Taylor House. And just to the right of it, you can see a buff color building that used to be headquarters building for the Cosmos Club, both kind of 19th century, early 20th century structures that at one time defined Lafayette Park as the 19th century residential area enclave for the elites, for the power brokers, and even as small as it is, 7 acres, a place that had some architecturally significant residences. Well, one reason that we know about this chapter in DC history and Mrs. Kennedy's history is thanks to this gentleman. And you all are going to recognize him, I bet, as author and historian David McCullough. In 1993, so it's not too long before Mrs. Kennedy is going to pass away from cancer. She and David McCullough are at a dinner together. They're seated next to each other. And he had an opportunity to make some public remarks. And he took that opportunity to thank her for what she had done for Lafayette Park in Washington, D.C. He turned to her and said, "Mrs. Kennedy, I'm sure you've been thanked many times for your efforts." And she looked back at him and she said, "Mr. McCullough, I've never been thanked." And so that led people at the National Trust for Historic Preservation to think this needs to be made public, what she did. And they proceeded to publish, the president of the National Trust published an editorial in the Washington Post. There used to be a Washington Post columnist named Sarah Booth Conroy. She wrote a few columns about Mrs. Kennedy's efforts in Lafayette Park. But then the person who really was the first to tell the whole comprehensive story was a doctoral student at the University of Virginia, someone named Kurt Helfrich, who happens to be a tour guiding colleague of ours now. But he was getting his doctorate in 1996 at UVA, and he was working on his dissertation, which was not about preservation Lafayette Park. It was about contemporary houses, Japanese modernism in the 1920s to the 1940s. But he submitted an article to Washington History Magazine in 1996, and that's the publication of the Historical Society of Washington. And it was called Modernism for Washington. And his thesis is that this episode between the White House administration, the General Services Administration, Lafayette Park architecture, public opinion, sort of crystallized the debate at the time in the 1950s and 1960s between the pull of modernism in architecture, but also particularly here in Washington, people's appreciation, or maybe some would say nostalgia, for 19th century architecture. And this is the what Mrs. Kennedy kind of walks into when she becomes First Lady. But first of all, let's go back to 1929. Here she is, just born with her mother, Janet. And in 1929, Lafayette Park was really in its heyday as a desirable place to live. It was still almost an entirely residential area in Washington, D.C. It had some really distinguished buildings. Here's a map. Excuse me, this is from the late 1880s, but it'll do for 1929 because many of these structures and a lot of this footprint still existed when Mrs. Kennedy was born. So if you all can see my cursor, oops, well, I'm not going to use my cursor, but see up where it says Arlington Hotel in the upper right-hand corner. That's where today's Veterans Affairs Administration building is and the McPherson Square Metro. So what I'm going to do is have us do a little tour of the square circa 1929, starting with the Arlington Hotel, and then we're going to go down Madison Place. We're going to go past the White House. We'll go past what was then the State War and Navy Department, which we today know as the Eisenhower Executive Office Building. We'll peek across the street where we have the Renwick Gallery today, the Blair House. We'll go up Jackson Place, and we will end along H Street at St. John's Church. The landscaping that you can see in the center of the square is about the same today as it was in 1929. Arlington Hotel, luxury hotel built in 1868 that Mrs. Kennedy's parents could have checked into and stayed with her when she was born. Again, this is where the VA department is today. Here on the corner, you're seeing what we know today as the Cutts Madison House, the Dolly Madison House, painted yellow today. Not looking quite as spiffy as it does right now. It's actually just gone a whole undergone an entire restoration. But that's on the corner. Next to it, that tall building with the ivy on it, is a headquarters building for the Cosmos Club that was purpose-built in 1909 for that organization. Now their headquarters is on Embassy Row. Next to that, you can see a low house that's from 1828 that was built by a man named Benjamin Taylor. And then you can just see next to that a very tall building that a lot of you probably won't recognize, but here it is. This was the Belasco Theater, or sometimes known as the Lafayette Opera House. And it had been built in 1895, and it was a place to go see live theater, live performances. And this was even still standing when the Kennedys came into the White House. When they came to the White House, this was probably being used as, had been being used as a USO building space during World War II. To the right of that, you can see some Ionic columns, and that is this building, the Treasury Annex building that had been built in 1922. And now you get a nice view again to its left of the old Belasco Theater. So again, these are all buildings that exist when Mrs. Kennedy's born. Here's the White House. This is an image from when Herbert Hoover was in the White House. And here is what was then the State Navy War Department. And this structure had been built to house those three agencies in, it opened in 1888, but it took many, many years to build. And it was constructed to house those three very large departments, which by 1929, post-World War I, they had all gotten very, very large and they weren't gonna fit into this building anymore. So this building is under consideration in the 1950s and 1960s to be torn down and replaced by an office tower. Renwick Gallery, what we know today, originally the Corcoran Gallery of Art, built in 1859. When the Kennedys come into office, this is probably being used or had been being used to house court of claims function. And that was another function that needed a new building. This was not big enough. Office space was needed for White House offices. Office space was needed for the Court of Claims and the Court of Appeals. Here's a little tiny image of the Blair House before it looks like today. And then here is the Decatur House on the other end of Jackson Place on the corner. And note that next to the Decatur House, there is that little annex that was built in the 1820s, but then next to it, we don't yet have a tall little office building that houses the headquarters of the National Grange that hasn't been built yet in 1929. Here is US Chamber of Commerce that had been built in actually the year Mrs. Kennedy was born. This is from 1929. Hay Adams Hotel had been built in 1928. St. John's Church, that had opened in 1816. So this illustrates that Lafayette Park was filled with really attractive 19th century buildings, many of which housed people or an organization like the Cosmos Club or an entertainment venue like the Belasco Theater. Well, here is President Dwight D. Eisenhower greeting brand new elected President John F. Kennedy in soon after November 1960. And it's nice they're both smiling. President Kennedy is gonna inherit some kind of thorny issues from President Eisenhower. And both of them are presiding as president at a time when America is really expanding post-World War II. We're building many highways. Our interstate highway system is starting. We are kind of envious and impressed about the Marshall Plan in post-war Europe. And we're thinking, hey, what could a Marshall Plan look like for the United States? And in some people's mind, it looks like the urban renewal movement, which is a real mixed blessing if you live in an urban area. But this pressing issue of office space, needed office space for the White House function, is something that President Kennedy has to look at immediately because President Eisenhower's administration has already started the ball rolling to figure out where are we going to put the offices and what are they going to look like? And how do we feel about this collection of, in some people's minds, old, outdated buildings in Lafayette Park? Should we just get rid of them all? Should we save some of them? What do we think about this? Well, a lot of you know, because you live in Washington, that the big real estate arm or agent for the federal government is the General Services Administration. And in 1957, they had gotten on it, but I wanted to show this is a stunning photo or a drawing, and I'm sorry it's so small, it's the best I could find. But plans for office space for the government in Lafayette Park did not originate with President Eisenhower's administration. This goes back to the late 1890s and early 1900s in America. This is a drawing that architect Cass Gilbert did of Lafayette Park around 1901, 1902. And the White House is down in the lower left or right corner. And then he has replaced every single 19th century building, including St. John's Church, with Beaux-Arts inspired office buildings to house the White House and other government functions, just like that. And this is at a time when there are big plans being made for Washington, DC via an initiative out of the Senate called the McMillan Commission. So this is, in some people's minds, kind of brazen, and some people's minds kind of horrifying, and some people's minds kind of like it's about time. You know, we need to kind of form needs to follow function, and this is all should be close to the executive mansion. Well, World War I interfered with this plan being able to be carried out whole scale, but the Chamber of Commerce Department headquarters, excuse me, and that Treasury Annex on the corner of Lafayette Park are both results of this image. But then I mentioned that the General Service Administration was very purposely thinking about what are we going to do now for office space in Lafayette Park. And they submitted this sketch in 1957, just an idea, a proposal about where maybe a new building could go. What you're looking at is Jackson Place. And the GSA folks have said, okay, we'll preserve the Decatur House on the far right of the image, and we'll preserve the sort of complex where the Blair House is at the left of the image. But then we'll just take out everything in the middle and we'll put in a sort of classically inspired office building with a larger office building at the back. And that should solve things. We could probably fit the White House function, the Court of Claims, and the Court of Appeals all in one place. So that's 1957. 1960, here comes President Kennedy, and here comes Mrs. Kennedy. 7 inches of snow was on the ground the day of the inauguration. But I love this photo of, I wish they were walking toward the White House, but they look excited, they look purposeful. And I love that here's this woman with a muff and fashionable yet sensible boots, trailing a whole collection of men behind her with a very jaunty, handsome man. You know, she's got her arm linked with his. She means business. And what I love is that as soon as he announced he was going to run for the presidency, she, in her mind, is already thinking, if he wins, my project is going to be the White House. It's going to be the restoration of the interior of that building, because she was aware that it hadn't really been maintained very well, that nobody with an eye to its history had really been involved, that furnishings from past administrations dating back to the era, say, of James Monroe had just been sold, had just been put in storage, people didn't know where it was. So she, in her mind, is thinking, this is what I'm going to do if I become the First Lady. Well, she does become the First Lady, and that's exactly what she's going to do. This is an image of the U.S. Chancery in London, designed by an architect named Eero Saarinen. And I showed you that GSA sketch proposed in 1957 about what to do in Lafayette Park. There were many people in Washington, sort of arbiters of taste, and people maybe who have been serving on what we know today as the Commission of Fine Arts, who said, we need to be done with the 19th century. We need to embrace this style of architecture, this kind of cutting edge modernism that really shows how progressive, how forward looking our country is. We were designing buildings like this for State Department buildings and Foreign Service buildings throughout the world. There was a hesitancy, though, to do this officially in Washington, D.C. Witness this. Here is Eero Saarinen again with his son, Eliel. And this is a model that they made for a proposed Smithsonian Museum of Art that would house modern art in the Smithsonian's collection. And this was proposed for the space where the Air and Space Museum is today. This proved to be just too much for official Washington. They just said, we cannot have that stark, modern, sleek building on our National Mall. No, we won't do that. So that never came to be. So again, we're maybe willing to put forth our modernist, forward-looking face in other countries where we need to build an embassy or a chancery. But right in our own backyard, on the National Mall, maybe not so eager. When the Kennedys come into office, any building project or change that's going to happen in what we call today the monumental core is maybe going to be pitched by the GSA, the General Services Administration, but it has to be approved by this collection of, I'm afraid, rather dour looking gentlemen. These are the seven people who constituted what was then called the Fine Arts Commission. And today we know it as the Commission of Fine Arts. And I want you to remember the men who are sitting down at the table, the one on the far right, kind of a little wizened face with big ears looking at us. He looks a bit like Frank Perdue. Well, that's David Finley. Remember David Finley. The other thing I want you to remember is that amongst this group, there were three of these gentlemen who were avowed modernists who wholeheartedly believed it was time for the federal government, for the White House to get out of the 19th century. And then there were people like David Finley, who actually knew the Kennedys, who is going to end up becoming a very close ally of Mrs. Kennedy, who had a very great appreciation for the legacy of the 19th century. Here he is with his wife at their estate in Virginia called Oatlands. Oatlands happens to be the very first property that was given to the National Trust for Historic Preservation when it was founded in the late 1950s. Would it come as a surprise to you that it was David Finley who was its first president? So he's on the Commission of Fine Arts. He is the first president of this new thing called the National Trust. And Mrs. Kennedy asks him to be part of a committee, a fine arts committee that she's forming at the White House to study the building and make recommendations to her about how to preserve it and refurnish it. And we all know, many of us, that this effort is showcased on national television in 1962. And here she is, this is a still from that CVS live production. Television is really new in 1962. It's just coming into people's homes. And suddenly people have an opportunity to tune in and not only see inside the house where the president lives, but also get to hear First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy guide them on a tour. And I wanna show a little clip of this tour. So I'm gonna stop sharing. And here it comes. Oop, wrong one, sorry. I'm so much better when I'm outdoors. Let's see what I do with it. Oh, shoot. Oh, here she is. All right. Now, you're going to be frustrated when this clip starts because you can't hear her very well and you can't see her very well, but just hang with it.
This state dining room symbolizes your duties as an official hostess. Do you serve many meals here?
Yes, this is where all the state dinners and lunches are given. Need 102 people, so the table now is not set up for that many.
Are there many state dinners?
Yes, there are. There were almost 2 a month last year.
Tell me about the silverware and the china, Mrs. Kennedy.
It's not silver. It's all gold or vermeil. They used to use Monroe's knives and forks, but so many of them have been lost, so they've been copied. And the china is the Eisenhower gold china. You see, so many of the beautiful old services the president's had were destroyed and broken. So now the Truman and the Eisenhower china is all that there's enough left of to use. And there is the beautiful Monroe centerpiece and his flower or fruit baskets and candelabra, all brought from France in 1817. And these glasses, they're ours. I wanted a very simple design so that the china and silver and glass would show up more. So I looked all over, and the prettiest ones I found came from West Virginia.
Well, they are beautiful.
And then this tablecloth is new. It's a gift to the White House from the firm of Porto. And it's all embroidered in gold to match the centerpiece and the knives and forks.
And these pictures, there are three of them in this room, the two behind us here.
Yes, these two were on loan from the Boston Museum of Fine Art. All three pictures in this room are by Healy. There's Thomas Jefferson, a copy after Stuart. And then there's Daniel Webster, who didn't live here, but he visited the White House for 40 years. And then the most famous one of all is this one of Abraham Lincoln, which traditionally always hung in the state dining room. Healy was a contemporary of Lincoln, but he only saw him once, so he painted this picture from photographs. And you can see two damaged spots on it, really quite bad ones. So we hope soon to have all the pictures in the White House that need repair repaired.
This is a perfectly beautiful room. Have you changed it a great deal?
No, we painted it white. This room's interesting because it has the most architectural unity of any room in the White House. It's really all 1902. When Theodore Roosevelt did the great restoration with Stanford White and his firm, McKim-Eaton White. The architecture, the consoles with the eagles, the furniture, the chandelier and the appliques. And it's interesting. People always think of Theodore Roosevelt with his stuffed animals and things. Few people realize that he was second only to Thomas Jefferson in his care and knowledge about the White House. In fact, he designed the one thing which is missing here, which will soon be given to us, a superb mantle. They, McKim-Eaton White had designed one with lion's heads, and Theodore Roosevelt said, no, the lion's not an American animal. So he designed it with buffalo heads, white marble, and McKim-Eaton White now is copying that for us. So you'll soon see it here to replace this just simple molding that was put in 1948.
So that's quite something. She's 31 years old when she's doing this. 57 million people watched that broadcast. That was a third of the American population at the time. She gets an Emmy Award for doing that. But it is so much more than just a very attractive, poised first lady showing us the White House. She's not talking like even a decorator. She's talking like a historian, and she is so perfectly inviting Americans to appreciate the history of this building, its heritage, where things were brought from Europe to house it in a very elegant way. And yet she's also very proud of America. She's getting that class from West Virginia. She is very knowledgeable of the building's architecture. She's very knowledgeable about the artists of the paintings. She's very knowledgeable about what the different presidents and their families did in the building. She's formidable. She kind of presents with this, you know, kind of coiffed hair and sheath dress and that little kind of whispery voice. But this was someone who ultimately, those dour Commission on Fine Arts men, she was gonna kind of prove to be their match. In a very significant way. So let's go back. Can we see it? Okay. So she's gonna have that in her arsenal of tools, this tour of the White House. But what she also has are allies, like this friend of President Kennedy's and hers, an artist called William Walton, who President Kennedy really trusted. He was gonna be really busy with a lot of things, but this Lafayette Park project meant a lot to him. He believed, President Kennedy did, that whatever happened with Lafayette Park was gonna be his legacy. I mean, little did he know what his ultimate legacy was going to be, but he wanted to put great care into this project, and he needed people who he knew understood his vision and his values, and William Walton was one of those people. So he says to William Walton, I do feel like it's good for us to preserve as much of the legacy, built legacy in 19th century Lafayette Park as we possibly can. The GSA has hired these architects now, two firms from Boston, to work on this project. The only guidance they've given them, Bill, is this little sketch that they've done of a building where they've eliminated everything on Jackson Place except the Blair House complex and Decatur House. I don't know how I feel about this. Can you kind of work on this for me? So Bill Walton does start to sort of interface with the architect team, and in his mind, and even President Kennedy's mind, why couldn't we have a building in the style of what was then called the Equitable Life Insurance Building? Today, Fannie Mae, actually today is going to become like a Harris Teeter, or I mean a Wegmans on Wisconsin Avenue, but this kind of neo-colonial architecture appealed to them. So William Walton draws this little sketch. He says, submits his own sketch. So we can see Decatur House on the far right, Blair House complex, far left. And then he's kind of drawn a smallish building, sort of colonial, neo-colonial inspired. And he's thinking, well, how about this? And he travels to Boston, he shows this to the architects, and I'm sure the architects were thinking, who is this man and why should we listen to him? But this idea is out there. Then, this is about 1961, out of the blue, kind of anonymously, an organization in DC called the Committee of 100 for the Federal City submits this to the Washington Post. And they say, hey, we're aware of the issues facing Lafayette Park. We're aware that there's pressure for new office space for the courts and the White House. We feel very strongly that there is a way to do this where we could preserve buildings and provide office space. And this is what we propose to do, or someone in our organization proposes. So you can see the little sketch at the top. And then below that is an actual photograph of Jackson Place at the time. And the Committee on 100 folks had put X's over high-rise buildings that had been placed on Jackson Place. And they said, let's tear those down. Those are not of the 19th century and they're not particularly architecturally significant. Instead, now let's look at the sketch above. We are going to leave those places blank. And why not just put a large office building behind all the 19th century buildings? Certainly you'd be able to fit everybody in there. So they run this in the Post. Post publishes it, people see it, and then that's kind of the end of that for the time being. Well, ultimately, this is the plan that is passed. The GSA proposes, President Kennedy okays it, and the Commission on Fine Arts okays it after a fight amongst the members. The modernists love this design. They say, yes, this is what we need. There's two very fine looking contemporary buildings. They wish that building on the far right, the tall one, that's the National Grange headquarters. They wish they could get rid of that, but they couldn't. And they said, if you must have the Decatur House and the Blair House complex saved, so be it. But what we like here is a very definite statement about modernism. But with modernism, you're also going to tear down a lot of Jackson Place. Also by this time, it was determined that there was no way that White House function, Court of Claims, and Court of Appeals could all go in one building or two buildings on Jackson Place. So there was a companion drawing for across the park on Madison Place that also kind of eliminated the middle and kept some historic buildings on the corners, the Dolly Madison House and then the Treasury Building. So this is what President Kennedy said, okay, if it has to be this, at least we're gonna save some of the buildings. People like David Finley were livid, but he was outvoted. And the architects thought, okay, well, mission accomplished. And I think the GSA thought, mission accomplished. Well, here's Mrs. Kennedy and her sister Lee Radiswell in India. And they look happy. And they look happy because Mrs. Kennedy had really managed to do something pretty significant by the time she gets to India. She finds out that her husband has agreed with this plan I just showed you. And she talks to David Finley and she says, this is not good. As long as we haven't started tearing down buildings yet, I think we can still do something here. Can't you just talk to the Commission on Fine Arts people? He goes, no, we voted. That's kind of, it's done now. The decision has been made. She does her tour of the White House, February 14 of 1962. And I said, 57 million people, a huge coup for her. So maybe she sort of takes the measure of her powers. And the very next day, she talks to David Finley and she says, let's go outside and look at the park. So they stroll around Lafayette Park together. And again, she says, I just think that we can do better than this plan. And I think it's really important that we try. And he said, Mrs. Kennedy, I agree with you, but my hands are tied. But maybe you could write a letter to Bernard Bootin, who's the head of the GSA, and tell him how you feel. And that's exactly what she did. Laura's gonna read us the letter.
All architects are innovators and would rather do something totally new than in the spirit of old buildings. I think they are totally wrong in this case, as the important thing is to preserve the 19th century feeling of Lafayette Square. Because of our interest in history and preservation, it really matters a great deal to the president and to myself that this is done well. We have received so much mail on this subject. Unfortunately, last summer, the president okayed some plans for buildings. He was in a hurry. He doesn't have time to bother himself with details like this. He trusted the advice of a friend, and I really don't think it was the right advice. With all he has to do, at least I can spare him some minor problems like this. So I turn to you for help. I so strongly feel that the White House should give the example in preserving our nation's past. Now we think of saving old buildings like Mount Vernon and tear down everything in the 19th century. But in the next 100 years, the 19th century will be of great interest, and there will be none of it left, just plain glass skyscrapers. Bobby says you are the most wonderful head of GSA there ever was or ever will be. I am sure this is true, and I cannot tell you how much I am counting on you. Before you know it, everything is ripped down and horrible things put up in their place. I simply panic at the thought of this and decided to make a last-ditch appeal.
Did she ever? Then she has to go off to India on sort of a goodwill ambassador trip. While she is gone, and this is just one of those things in a president's administration in DC history, American history, one of these coincidences that sort of bumbles in the form of this gentleman, John Carl Warnecke, knows President Kennedy. He went to college at Stanford. President Kennedy did like a semester at Stanford when he was an undergrad or did a summer course or something, and they got to know each other. And while he was studying at Stanford as an undergrad, John Carl Warnecke was a star on the football team. Their football team like won the championship in 1940, and President Kennedy knew all about that. Well, he happens to be in Washington in March of 1962. Mrs. Kennedy sends that letter to Bernard Bootin on March 6, goes off to India. He's in DC for a meeting. Architect meeting, that's his profession now, and he's actually kind of making a name for himself as an American architect. And President Kennedy finds out he's in town and says, hey, I'm having a reunion at the White House of my PT boat brothers. from World War II, come on over. So he shows up at the White House. The first thing that President Kennedy says to him is, "Hello, Rose Bowl," meaning, "Hey, you're the guy who was on the Stanford team that won the Rose Bowl." And they get to talking, and suddenly President Kennedy says, "Hey, we've got this kind of sticky problem about Lafayette Park and architecture. I'm not entirely satisfied with the outcome. Why don't we take a look at it tomorrow?" So long story short, President Kennedy and John Carl Warnecke go walk around Lafayette Park the next day. Warnecke thinks, okay, he just wants my opinion. He just wants me to give him some advice. And he starts to say to him, "Well, Mr. President, I really could see a way where you could satisfy the need for large, maybe somewhat modernist office buildings, but I see a way to really preserve a lot of this 19th century architecture." President Kennedy gets really excited about this, and he goes, "Well, tell me more." And John Carl Warnecke's saying, "Well, but you already have a plan." And President Kennedy says, "Maybe we don't have a plan. Maybe I want you to execute a plan." And with that, in a way maybe only a president can do, President Kennedy sort of jettisoning this GSA, Commission on Fine Arts approved architecture plan for Lafayette Park, and he brings on John Carl Warnecke. Word of this gets back to Mrs. Kennedy once she arrives back from India, and she first person she wants to tell about this is her confidant and ally, David Finley. And she writes a letter to him, which Laura is going to read. She writes this in April 1962.
"Hold your breath, because this is what is going to happen. All our wildest dreams come true. The new court building will be 19th century in feeling, similar to Bank. 2, the Dolly Madison and Taylor houses will be saved. 3, the Court of Claims will be saved. It will be, I think, turned into a museum of modern art, which people are trying to get started here, and which I said I would sponsor, as I think it is wrong to identify oneself solely with art of the past, and never encourage what is happening now. So it will be used as it used to be. 4, the whole Decatur House side facades will be saved, except for the 2 tall modern buildings. Some will be used as extension of guest facilities at Blair House. The rest is offices. So Theodore Roosevelt's old house and place where National Gallery was born will be preserved."
How about that? So John Carl Warnecke becomes the architect of record for what's going to happen in Lafayette Park. The Boston architects, perhaps by this time, maybe gratefully say, "We're gonna bow out." The GSA says, "Fine, good." And the Commission on Fine Arts, many of them really steam coming out of their ears, say, "Okay, we're willing to look at whatever plans this new architect comes up with." And here's what he comes up with. This is probably the most well-known image of this Lafayette Park plan that we live with today that John Carl Warnecke designed. And there he is with Mrs. Kennedy. When he made his presentation to the Commission on Fine Arts, she attended. She sat in the front row. So they would see her and they would be very aware that she was on board with this. And I love this model because what it shows us is that indeed, he did manage to preserve most of the buildings along Jackson Place. And as we all know today, if we live here in DC, set back behind it quite a way, a very large office building to house White House offices. Directly across the park to the east, he designed a similar office building to be set back behind the 19th century buildings, most of them on Madison Place. Here they are looking at a long drawing that he did of Jackson Place. So here is Lafayette Park, more or less today. What is in this illustration near the upper left-hand corner, new executive office building. That is what was designed by John Carl Warnecke. Directly across the park to the right or to the east, you see U.S. Court of Appeals and U.S. Court of Federal Claims. That is the other office building that he designs for those functions. And here is an illustration that shows these buildings were put up in the early 1970s. So this one is Madison Place. Unfortunately, the sacrificial lamb building for Madison Place was the Belasco Theater building. That got knocked down. And now when you enter the Court of Claims, Court of Appeals complex, that entry building is where the theater used to be. But everything else on Madison Place was preserved. What was remarkable at the time was that John Carl Warnecke designed these circa 1970s buildings with brick facades. He even has the idea of sort of a mansard or sloped roof at the top. And look at those extended bays at the top of the building. These are all elements from 19th century architecture. He referred to what he was doing as contextual architecture. He believed this is how you should approach a site where there are existing 19th century buildings. Sure, you want to nod toward modernity, but you also want to nod back to what came before. There were a lot of people that rolled their eyes at this and thought it was sort of just facadism, but there are as many people that saw the value in it, and it became contextual architecture, as it was called then, became a tool, an approach that architects were going to use and are still using today in our city. So here's Jackson Place, showing the new executive office building in the background. And you know that that one sketch showed X's where there were those little high-rise office buildings that were to be eliminated. Those are eliminated. And in their place, John Carl Warnecke designed 1970s buildings to look like 19th century buildings. So really taking the idea of contextual architecture to its fullest, sort of to its extreme. And you have to look really carefully at the brick and the mortar to tell which is 19th century and which is 1970s. Now, I'm gonna go back here. On this side of Lafayette Park on Jackson Place, if you are walking right past the building we can see in the middle of the image, which it looks like it has three black doors, that's the entrance to what used to be the entrance to the White House Conference Center. And now since September 11, you can't go through those doors anymore. But just to the right of that door, first black door, is now today this plaque. And again, this is something that you would miss if you didn't know it was there. And look at the top of this plaque. Do you recognize that sketch? Do you recognize that sketch from that article that someone on the Committee of 100 submitted to the Washington Post? Well, here's what happens, and this is really one of the most interesting aspects of this story. Mrs. Kennedy passes away. There is understandably a long period of examining her legacy, celebrating her legacy, remembering her. The National Trust tells folks, hey, this is what she did in Lafayette Park. She should be better known. They put that pedestal out. And then the Washington Post receives a letter from Rosemary Chapman, which Laura is going to read.
I enjoyed Sarah Booth Conroy's article, Preserving Lafayette Square, home, May 26. It was a warm, interesting, and fitting tribute to Jacqueline Kennedy and her husband. I am surprised, however, by John Warnecke's apparent reluctance to give credit to my late husband, Grosvenor Chapman, for the concept used to save the historic buildings on Jackson Place. It was Chapman's sketch, which was shown to President and Mrs. Kennedy by William Walton of the Fine Arts Commission, that convinced the Kennedys that the historic houses bordering Lafayette Square could be preserved. Although Warnecki states that he never saw the sketch until long afterward, it would not have been necessary for him to have done so. The Kennedys were already sold on Chapman's concept, which was to remove all buildings on Jackson Place except the historic houses and locate the executive office building on 17th Street. The president only had to ask Warnecki if he could accomplish this prior to commissioning him. John Warnecki did a splendid job in executing Grosvenor Chapman's concept. But if it were not for the input of many others who came before Chapman, the architectural heritage of Lafayette Square could never have been saved.
Well, so there is that. And friends and family of Grosvenor Chapman had this plaque erected to correct the record, to add to the record, certainly to give him and his sketch, for indeed he was the one whose sketch was submitted to the Washington Post. He was the member of the Committee on 100, the Federal City. And the point his wife is making is that, yeah, he was championing contextual architecture as well. That's what the Kennedys wanted. And John Carl Warnecki sort of executed that. But there's another name and another influence that we need to recognize. And it's Grosvenor Chapman, who now I would say is the unsung hero of the Lafayette Park preservation story. I'm glad that plaque is there. And I love that this sort of little quirk, this little prologue or epilogue to the story exists. That's kind of a very Washington story. But let's not at all discount Mrs. Kennedy's influence on preservation in the United States. On the 40th anniversary, this is 2006, of the National Preservation Act, Preservation Magazine, which is the magazine that the National Trust publishes, had a really wonderful article about Mrs. Kennedy's preservation legacy, focusing on Lafayette Park and saying that what she helped get accomplished in Lafayette Park, that preservation of so much 19th century architecture, coupled with what she did with the White House, how she raised Americans' awareness of the value, not just the need, but the value and the joy and just the interest in preserving our history. That gave way and it gave momentum so that when people like David Finley, chairman of the new National Trust for Historic Preservation, Commission on Fine Arts, when they go to propose the government that there be a federal act to preserve buildings in the United States, in 1966, it passes. And looking back in 2006 and still today, people point to Mrs. Kennedy, age 31, just a couple years into being a first lady, what she was able to do really gave heft to that movement. And she goes on, as many of us know, many of you all know, in her life to continue to be a champion of architectural preservation in cities. Here she is outside of Grand Central Station in New York. She helped to get this building landmarked and not torn down. She's probably most famously known for working tirelessly to get the very grand Beaux-Arts Pennsylvania Station in New York City designated, not successful in that case. But this is really a part of her story of First Lady that we owe so much to her. And we can still be grateful. We're still inheritors of the very, very good thing that she did in Lafayette Park. So we're nearly out of time, but if anyone has any questions, happy.
We have a question. And this is about the Committee of 100, was there any coordination with Jane Jacobs on this?
Oh, no, there was not. Nope. But for people like David Finley, I don't know about Mrs. Kennedy, but anybody at that time who was fearful and decried the sort of wanton destruction of urban fabric, particularly when the highway system came through a city, Jane Jacobs was their hero, and also just someone who could give words to their own feelings and their own vision.
There is a request for any books that you might recommend about this subject.
No one has written a book about this as far as I know yet. The, I put it down. Hold on one second. The issue of Washington History that this is from, that Kurt's article, this is what it looks like. And it came out in 1996. You can, if you're a member of the Historical Society of Washington, you can access that article. I think that is the best right now. That's the best source of chronicling everything that happened. Since that time, the best information I have found has all been on the National Trust for Historic Preservation's website. They seem right now to kind of own this story. This would be a great dissertation. Someone should write it.
So this one is not a question, but a statement. It says, the plaque makes no mention of Finley's role in the National Trust for Historic Preservation. Yeah. Perhaps you can elaborate on that a little?
I don't really know much about that plaque at all. It's interesting, even when the Trust writes these couple laudatory articles about Mrs. Kennedy's work and on behalf of Lafayette Park, they do not mention erecting that plaque. They don't mention that we had a ceremony. They don't even, you know, as you notice, there's not even a date of when that plaque was erected. It's kind of vague, I think. I don't know. They could have done a better job, I agree. And they could have credited David Finley, for sure. Who's actually, David Finley's wife, Margaret, was born in William Corcoran's old house on Lafayette Park. She spent part of her girlhood living on Lafayette Park. William Corcoran's old house was torn down to build the U.S. Chamber of Commerce headquarters. So I mean, he really had a vested interest in the park.
A follow-up question about that. So the plaque did, however, say F, and I'm assuming that's short for Finch, was founding director of the NGA. Is that true?
Yeah. Yes, that's correct. He was. He was amazing. I mean, he was sort of he was everywhere in that period of Washington, D.C. Fine Arts Commission, National Trust, and National Gallery of Art. Yes, Andrew Mellon tapped him to be the founding director of that museum.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think we are almost 10 minutes past our time, so perhaps it's time to move on and let participants know what they can expect next.
So next week, and I want to say thank you to Laura. Superb. I got a chill. It was really great.
Thank you.
next Wednesday at this time, Washington Walks guide Martin Murray is going to talk about, in general, DC's rainbow history, LGBTQ history that he has been involved in documenting and collecting and honoring for a couple decades now. He's a founding member of an actual initiative called Rainbow History. And his point of departure is going to be those two women sitting there, Lucy Slow Diggs and Mary Burrell, whose house in Brookland is now applied for historic designation as an LGBTQ historic site. So Martin's going to talk about that. And then another couple from the 19th century who also have some DC history marks, Walt Whitman and his life partner, Pete Doyle. Tonight at 7, DC film critic Mike Canning is going to discuss and look at the film Advise and Consent.
Wonderful. And I would just like to remind everyone again, especially if you joined us a little bit late, that these webinars are now available on our website and our brand new YouTube channel. So if you are so inclined, if you'd like to subscribe to that, that'd be lovely. We'd appreciate having you on there. And you can look forward to these recordings going up probably within a day or two after each one is completed. So if you happen to miss a part or you'd like to recommend it to a friend, that's a great resource. Just check out our website.
Glory hallelujah to the All right, thanks everyone. Nice to be with you. Thanks again, Laura.
Thank you so much for having me.
Be in touch about the next one.